Hi, thank you. My name is Donny Kurniawan. I work at REA Group, and welcome to building backend for iOS and macOS without managing server. I come from Indonesia, so when I say it means you are awesome. All right, so without managing server is also known as serverless. So throughout this talk, I'm going to use the word serverless because without managing a server, it's quite a mouthful. Okay, so I'm going to explain what it means, what serverless is later, but I just want to state what the objective for the talk is. So the objective of the talk is to introduce and demonstrate various serverless platforms. This talk aims for breadth rather than for depth. So there are various things that I couldn't talk about because of the time, but I'm going to explain what those things are later. All right, let's move on to the agenda for this talk. So introduction, I'm going to introduce three platforms, introduce and demonstrate three platforms, IBM OpenWhisk, Google Cloud Functions, and AWS Lambda. And I'm going to give a summary later. So what is serverless? Traditionally, the software developer, they had to be aware of the concept of a server when they develop software. Servers have IP address, you can SSH to the server, they have file system, etc. But with serverless, we have the absence of server during software development. We don't think about servers anymore. We just write our functions, and then we just deploy it somewhere. And we trust the cloud runtime that to execute our code. The server runs on a managed hardware and software platforms of the platform, of the company. So basically, we don't need to think much about the CPU, we don't need to think much about the memory size, web server, port number, and so forth. Serverless code encourages us to write well-defined units of business logic. So basically, serverless code typically very small, probably just a function or just a module. And those functions, they got executed because of an event, either, HTTP events call, or it's because of internal events from the platform. With serverless, they encourage us to externalize persistence. They encourage us to use, for example, S3 to store our data or Google Cloud Storage. Because with serverless, you don't have access to the file system. You just think of the file system as a local cache, but don't store anything on the file system. With serverless, it encourages you if you have two or more serverless codes and they are dependent, they encourage you to externalize the dependencies with message bus service. Serverless platform, normally they have limited runtime and higher latency. So limited runtime normally is like around 5 minutes, which means that there are certain cases that are not suitable for serverless code. Bitcoin mining is one of them. There are some use cases that are not suitable for serverless, like Bitcoin mining or video processing. Although, of course, with like video processing, you can use external services that perform video processing for you. So where does serverless sit in the context of cloud computing offering? Traditionally, we have infrastructure as a service. We have platform as a service. We have backend as a service. So I guess in terms of abstraction, I think serverless sits between backend as a service and platform as a service. So I'm going to move on to the next, the platform, IBM OpenWhisk. Oh, if you have questions, please note the questions, and then there will be another QA later. So OpenWhisk, it has been described as a distributed event-driven programming service. It provides programming model where basically developers, they upload event handler to various events. The events themselves, they can come from IBM services like Cloud N, also can come from direct invocations like HTTP. IBM OpenWhisk is still an experimental stage, so they can change in backward incompatible way. So be aware of that. They offer web console to interact with OpenWhisk, but normally you use the WhisK command line interface tool. You can write your action in JavaScript, Swift, or you can upload a Docker image where they run the binary for you. It allows you to run Swift, but of course you need to be aware that the version of Swift is Swift for Linux. I think it's about Swift 2.2, so just be aware of the difference. They also provide SDK for iOS. All right, demo time. All right. Hello. Okay. All right. So OpenWhisk is very easy to install. It's just basically you install OpenWhisk. It's just a pip install, and then I think you need to run a command to set up the credentials. But once you are done, you are ready to go. Let's try with one function. Hcat greet someone. Hcat greet someone. It's a hello world function. It's a Swift function. We can create our first OpenWhisk function by action create. Give our function a name, greet someone. Done. We can run it. Action invoke greet someone. Parump name Jones. Blocking. I'm going to talk about why we have blocking there and results. Toot. Ah, hello Jones. So what it does is you send a parameter named Jones to OpenWhisk. They spin up a Docker where they run Swift on Linux, run your code, and then send you the outputs. If we omit the results, it's going to give you like the whole thing, like result status and the success. But normally I just use results. We can omit blocking. It comes with an ID where you can basically activation results and copy paste, and you get the result back. Okay, let's do something interesting. We have two function. We have a function here called sort. So basically, I'm going to action create sort, sort.swift. We can call the function again, invoke source blocking results param payloads. The payload needs to be a JSON string. So what it does, the function of what it does is it sorts the array of strings A, B, C. We can also have another function called uppercase, which basically uppercase the string. We can create uppercase Swift. And again, we can uppercase the string, which becomes a capital A, capital C, and capital B. Now, with OpenWhisk, you can sequence those functions. So, action create uppercase sort, sequence uppercase sort. And as a result, you're gonna get capital. Yeah, it's a typo. You're gonna get capital A, capital B, and capital C. So this is quite a powerful construct where basically you can compose functions individually and then just sequence them together. All right. Let's go back to the slides. So this is OpenWhisk. Next platform is Google Cloud Functions. Google Cloud Functions has been described as a lightweight and event-based compute solution. It sounds familiar because I think basically that's how the serverless platforms describe themselves, lightweight and event-based. It allows you to create a single purpose functions that responds to cloud events. And the beauty of it, you don't need to manage the runtime environment of the server. You let Google handles everything for you. Of course, Google, like OpenSwift, OpenWhisk, Google Cloud Function is still alpha release. So you need to apply and be whitelisted to use the Google Cloud Functions. The interaction primarily is done through the gcloud command line interface tool. And unfortunately, different to OpenWhisk, you need to write the code in JavaScript. It's executed in the managed Node.js environment by Google, and they offer two distinct cloud functions. HTTP and background functions. The foreground functions, basically the functions that can be called by HTTP calls, and background functions, they are functions that can be called by the Google services. All right. Demo. I'm going to go to Google. Edge cat index.js. Alias. Edge cat index.js. All right. With Google Cloud Functions, normally you are given a Git repository where you commit your code and then you push and then you deploy the code from the Git repository. So that's what we're going to do. We have an index.js file. We are going to index.js. Hello. git add, git commit, change code, git push. And you can deploy, the function by doing this. So what it means is, it's the gcall function, googcall functions, deploy the name of the function, hello message function, the source URL, which is the git repository that Google gives to you, default, the directory, which is hello message here. You specify that you want the function to be triggered by HTTP, which is here. Search parent master and entry point, hello message, which is the name of the function. And you deploy the class. You deploy the function. And you can just call it by calling Google gcall alpha functions call and pass the parameter. And hello, Alex. Obviously, you can do curl. Once you specify the correct permission, you can call it using curl. Hello, Steve. Almost all of those serverless platforms, they make the functions available via HTTP. So actually, you can use this serverless for your iOS, Mac, Android, web, or anything. It's basically publicly accessible. All right, so I'm going to move to the next example. For this demo, I'm going to run it first, and I'm going to explain how it works later. Okay. So, okay. So we have the Google console here, which they have two buckets. They are empty. And I'm going to, I need an image, so I'm going to google.image.google.com. I need a French text, or maybe German. Let's try German, maybe try French. French text poetry. It's Klingon. Maybe don't put poetry. This one looks good. So view image. I'm going to download it. MV download. What's it called? Text. French. I'm going to upload this French image to Google Cloud Function. So gsutil cp French gsdevworld image bucket. So basically the function that we have here is going to perform OCR of the image, optical character recognition, using the Google Fusion API, and then it's going to perform translation using the Translate API. GSDevWorld text bucket. French to n.txt. of course. Voila, you have the English text. openfrench.gif. Where is it? The French image. Does anyone here speak French? Is it correct? I assume it's correct. You know, it's from Google, so I assume it's correct. All right. So how does this magic work? Let's go back to the slide. All right, so we wrote two functions called process image, called translate text and save result. And we have two buckets. One is default image bucket where we upload the image, and we have text word text bucket to store the resultant text. We have the Google pub sub topic where we subscribe. That it is the message bus service to connect the data between those two functions. So basically, we have an image here where we upload to the Google Cloud Storage. This one triggers a function called process image, and it makes use of the Google Fusion service and the Google Translate service to perform OCR of the text. It wraps the text as a JSON and then push it to default translate topic that triggers another function called translate text. And then translate text makes use of the translate service to translate from French to English. And then pass the output to the result topic, which gets saved as a text file in the text default text bucket storage. So that's Google Cloud Functions. I'm going to move on to the next platform, AWS Lambda. It has been built as the zero administration compute platform, which, you know, again, sounds very familiar. AWS takes care of provisioning and managing the servers. So it does OS operating system maintenance, it does provisioning, it does automatic scaling, code monitoring, and logging. It can scale from like a few requests per day to thousands per second. You write your code in Node.js, Java, or Python. And the good thing is it's production ready. So you don't need to apply to use it. You just sign in for AWS account, and then you can use Lambda straight away. It's super cool. The Lambda itself, it can be executed as an HTTP calls using the Amazon API gateway or events from AWS resources like S3, DynamoDB, or Kinesis. With the other platforms like OpenWhisk or Google Cloud Functions, normally the HTTP endpoint is typically coupled with the code. So the platform does minimal transformation between the JSON from the HTTP to the function. But AWS, they externalize the HTTP endpoint, so as an API gateway, which is basically a fully managed service for HTTP endpoints. Think of it as a layer between the users and the app logic that can do throttling and DDoS protection. It can also perform caching layer for responses from Lambda, so API gateway. demo time. For this demo, I'm going to create the function from the console. So I'm going to create Lambda function. I normally just keep the function. I can choose the trigger. You can use API Gateway, Alexa, CloudWatch, DynamoDB, Kinesis, or S3. But in this scenario, I'm going to use API Gateway. I'm going to give my name half default hello empty. Okay, I'm going to use test. I'm going to use post. Oh no, test. Post. Production. I'm going to make it open so that you can just call the HTTP endpoint directly. Next. I think this sounds good. So. Test function. I'm going to stick with the Node.js. You can write your code inline here, or you can just zip a directory and upload it to Amazon. Index handler. I'm going to just a basic one. Existing Lambda basic. I'm going to, and then I'm just going to next and create a function. So we've got this. Oh, very small. So basically, we have this URL that we can just call straight away. We can, oh, I'm going to move to Amazon. We can curl expose. Specify the header. Accept application JSON. And specify the argument, ping. Pong, which is basically as you can take a look at the function here. I will index.js. Oh, yeah, yes. Send a ping, and you got a pong. You know, as simple as that. All right. For the next demo, I'm going to make use of Twilio. So LMS edge. RM function. Function call function. So this is what the function looks like. It makes use of the Twilio service, where basically you post whatever you want to say to the function, and it's going to call a number and then say it out loud. So I'm going to, rather than using the web console, I'm just going to use the script. update Lambda. Boom. All right, so how do we call this function? Therefore Lambda, I think this is correct. All right. Hello from default, your trusty the developer. Okay. Never fear. I'm sure this is solvable. Function index. Yes. All right. Ding ding ding. Function. All right. Maybe let me give my. Please don't robocall me. all right, as function. As function index.js, yes. Try again. Oh, of course. It's because I put my phone on disturb. Yeah, correct. And hello. And I'm going to answer it. Hello from default developers. But wouldn't be cool if we can. Wouldn't be cool if we can call our functions from Google Cloud Functions. So from the translation example just now, this one is going to call our Lambda and send the text and deploy. I was so busy preparing for the slides that I didn't think of jokes, you know. Sorry. All right, so if we go to the example again, I have, let's go with, let's go with the French again. Menu. All right. Oh man, Tmux. All right. Cap test. I'm going to run this test. Open example. Oh. It doesn't work. We have this menu. Of course, it's because I didn't upload. I didn't push the code. Push code. Git push. And deploy. All right, example, I'm going to run the test again. Oh, no, there's one thing, there's not. Oh yeah, of course, we have deployed. I'm going to run the test. Oh no, must be something wrong. But you got the gist, right? All right. So let's go to the slides and I'm going to give you a summary. So serverless, there are still servers running in the cloud. Even though it says serverless, yeah, there are still servers running the functions. And you just need to be aware when you write your functions. And the serverless, basically, they act like glue code. Think of serverless as shell script for your cloud services. They fit naturally in the microservices architecture. So, you know, if you have bash script, I think serverless is basically your bash script equivalent. There are several use cases like pre or post processing for your requests. You can use serverless for tracking and logging. And you can even use serverless for backend wrapper for storage or compute. So in this talk, I have introduced and demonstrated various serverless platforms. There are other considerations that I haven't had the chance to talk about, which is user authentication and security, and error reporting and network failure. So before you run it in production, make sure that you consider this other stuff. So what's the way forward? Evaluate serverless, experiment with serverless, use it, and reassess. And that's about it. Questions?
This is Michael, who does work excellent. Does anybody have a question for Donny? Questions? Okay, I'm going to go over here. That's you.
Matt.
Hey, Donny. Awesome talk. Unfortunately, demo got through. with serverless, what sort of persistence layers, like databases, NoSQL, that sort of stuff, do you have access to?
So the question was, what sort of persistent surface accessible from the serverless? Normally, it depends on the underlying platform. So for example, if you use Lambda, normally they encourage you to use DynamoDB or S3 for the persistence. Or if you use Google Cloud Functions, you normally use the Google Bigtable or the Google Cloud Storage. It's very rare for function to use the other competing platform persistent services, you know, because of the latency issue. So normally the companies, they offer their own persistent services to be used by the serverless.
Thank you once again, great talk. All of those three you mentioned, the Lambda, Cloud Functions, OpenWhisk, and I think Azure Functions.
Yes, Azure Functions, yep. This is my 2 cents opinion. I prefer Lambda because it's just production ready. You know, you can use it for production straight away. I think REA, the company, they use Lambda in production. On the other hand, I think I also like Google Cloud Functions simply because like they come after Lambda. So sometimes if you take a look at the APIs and the documentation, it's much nicer. It's more, you know, structural. So.
Do you have any questions over this side of the room? Anyone here?
Great demo. Thank you very much for your presentation. How do you resolve, obviously it's very dependent to internet connectivity,
yes,
and serverless. How do you work around caching or just making those data still available even though like this demo that you, yeah? How do you work around that?
Yes, I have a slide. I have a website for that one. It's a big topic, you know. I can't cover it, but basically, this is the fallacy of distributed computing. We can't assume all of this to be true. So, unfortunately, I think it's beyond the scope of the talk. Yeah.
No more questions for Donny? Well, that was a wonderful introduction to everything that's available in serverless computing at the moment, and thank you very much for your talk.
Thank you. Thank you.